One pair of hands formed the mountains. One pair of hands formed the sea. One pair of hands formed the moon and stars. Every bird, every flower, every tree. One pair of hands formed the valleys, the oceans, the rivers, the sand. Those hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands healed the sick. One pair of hands raised the dead. One pair of hands calmed the raging storm. And thousands of people were fed. I love you, and those hands were nailed to a tree. Those hands are so strong, so when your life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. Put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and has shed his own blood o'er my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glory was nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the saved shall be sighed.
Old-time preacher in a small-town church bows his head to pray. Early morning echoes off the empty walls of that sacred place. In 3 short hours, this room will be filled up with desperate souls. He's begging God to tell them what they need to know when a still, small voice says, tell them that I love them, that I died to set them free, and tell them there's an answer for everything they need, and tell them there's forgiveness and hope in suffering. The truth never gets old, so say it again and again. Tell them that about Charlie, who just said goodbye to his bride and old-time preacher in a small-town church bows his head to pray.
Stand with me if you would tonight. Let's go to prayer over the Word of God. Heavenly Father, as we come before you once again tonight, God, we just thank you for another day, another opportunity, and another chance just to worship and praise you. Father, we just ask that you just continue to move your Spirit through this place. God, you go with us just one more time. Help the words that flow from my lips be from the throne room of heaven tonight. God, we just thank you for all that you do for us. We'll be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory for it. In your precious holy name we pray tonight. Amen and amen. You can be seated. As you're sitting, turn with me, if you would, to the book of Genesis in chapter number 22. Genesis chapter number 22. It's good to be back home tonight. Been a while since we've been able to be here. We don't get out very often. The duties of pastoring take a lot. So we don't get to go out, don't get to go very many places anymore, which we're thankful for the calling that God has placed, but it's good when we get to come back home every now and then. Amen. So it's good to be here tonight. It's good to see so many new faces that I've not seen in a while. Good to see some old faces. Not that you're old in age, it's just I haven't seen you in a while. And it's good when, it's right, Tam, I was talking about you. But it's good when I have to turn to Doug and I say, who's that? Who's that person back there? Because that shows that you're still going with exactly what you've had this whole time. Still trusting in the Lord. Still sharing the good news. Knowing that God still changes souls. Amen? I'm thankful for that fact. Thankful for that fact tonight. Genesis chapter number 22. Be looking at one verse there in chapter 22. If you're there and you love the Lord, say amen. Amen. Look at verse number 14 with me if you would. It says, and Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh. As it is said to this day in the mount of the Lord, it shall be seen. One verse, but this speaks volumes. We know in chapter 22, we're talking about a very famous story that most of us know a whole lot about. If we've been around church very long, we've heard the story of Abraham and Isaac. We've heard the story of what took place and how Abraham was given this rather strange command from the Lord that he was to offer up his son Isaac. The Lord had given him that commandment that he was supposed to take his son. He's supposed to take him up to the mount and then offer him up as the sacrifice on that mount. So Abraham, being the man of God that he was, he got everything ready for that process. He got the wood packed, he got the fire ready, he got Isaac ready, and they took off on their journey. And the Bible says that they took off with him and Isaac and everything and a few men, and they went about on their way up to the mount in order to sacrifice as the Lord had commanded. And so I begin to think in my mind when I read stories like this and I study stories like this about the thoughts that would go through the minds of these people as they're trying to fulfill the call that God has given them. Doing what God has asked of them to do. And I can only imagine what Abraham was thinking as he was going through the process of beginning to walk up to this place to offer up his son as a sacrifice to the Lord. Not only can I think about what he is thinking, but I think about what's going through the mind of Isaac as he is also walking with his father up to do this sacrifice. However, there is not a sacrifice in hand for them to offer up. And so the going through the mind of each one of these people, knowing that God has called them to do the sacrifice and they just need to be obedient to follow through with what God has given. And so they begin to walk to this place in complete obedience to God. Abraham knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that if he was to offer up Isaac as this sacrifice, that God would raise him back to life once again. That God would bring him back to life to him once again. We can look at Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 19, where it says, accounting that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. And so we're looking back to this process of this sacrifice that is being made.
He knew that as long as he was to be obedient to what God had called him to do, that God was going to see to everything that he had given for him at this time. And so they come to this place, and as they walk on a little longer, they get to the point where Abraham tells his men to stay back behind. They're going to go up to Mount Moriah, and they're going to offer the sacrifice to the Lord. Now, could you imagine as Abraham lays the wood upon the back of Isaac, and they trek up the mount to the top to make the sacrifice to the Lord? What's continuing to go through his mind? What are we going to offer? What has God got to provide for us? Abraham, knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that God was going to provide a sacrifice, he just had to be obedient to the calling of God. And so they make their way up to the top. They have the wood ready. They build the altar. They lay the wood upon the altar. Abraham binds Isaac by his hands and by his feet and lays him upon the altar of sacrifice before the Lord. As he is beginning to fulfill what God has called him to do, he's beginning to fulfill, to give the sacrifice that God has commanded. The Bible says an angel stays his hand and says, just wait just 1 minute before he's going to give this sacrifice, in order to hold the sanctity of the life of Isaac in the hands of Abraham. The Bible says that Abraham looks up as his hand is being held by the angel, and he sees a ram caught in the thicket just beyond the sacrifice that was given, knowing that God had given the provision that was needed. All that God had commanded from Abraham was that he be obedient to what was going to take place. Abraham just had to be obedient to the calling of God, knowing that God was going to supply all of his need according to his riches and glory. Knowing that God was going to give everything that was needed, Abraham just had to be a little obedient to the call of God. Have you ever been to a place in your life where God has called you to something that seemed kind of strange? God has laid something in your lap that seems kind of strange. God lays something upon you that's a little different than what you're used to. But God is calling you to be obedient in that time of need, knowing that he's going to supply all your need. There is no reason to worry. There's no need to fear. Because as long as we trust in God, he's going to give everything that's needed. As long as we trust in God, he's going to supply the provision that's laid out in front of us. There's no need to fear in what God has called us to. There's no need to fear in the things that God lays in our lap. Because if we trust in the big hand of God, we know that he's going to supply those needs. We know that he's got the provision laid out. He's going to give us exactly what is needed. All we've got to do is be obedient to him, trust in him with everything that we are, knowing that he's got the paths laid through each and every time that we come up to something. Here's the thing that we've been talking about at our church. God gave us the vision for our body of believers to begin the year of 2020. One of the things that we talked about was the word unity. And what God began to give was an individual message for each letter of the word unity. And I don't know if you know this or not, but pastors love it when God gives a series of messages, because then you don't have to worry about what's coming up next. God's already got it for you. Hallelujah. And it's wonderful. And so God began to lay this out for us and began to give us exactly what was needed. And the end of unity that God began to give was that we noticeably see the provisions of the Spirit of God. That we noticeably see the provisions of the Spirit of God. And he began to lay out exactly what it took to see the provisions of God and the providing power of God Almighty, knowing that he was going to give what was needed exactly in that place. And so when we got down to the end of this word unity, we began to dig in and see what God was going to lay in our lap. And he began to say that we need to noticeably see the provisions of God in this day and time. Why? Because we got people out here that don't believe anything that the Lord can do. We got a bunch of church folk today that don't believe that God is who he said he is. We got a bunch of people that say they want to believe in God and they want to follow after God. But when the rubber meets the road and things get a little difficult from time to time, you see them tuck tail and dive out because they're not ready and they don't trust Him. But we see a saint of God getting to that place of sacrifice, knowing that God was going to provide no matter what it looked like, no matter what God had commanded, knowing that He was going to supply exactly what was needed in this time of sacrifice. And so the Bible says that as he seen the ram caught in the thicket and was given the provision for the sacrifice, that he named this place Jehovah Jireh, meaning the Lord provides. When we look at verse number 14, at the end of that verse, it says, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. And so the word Jehovah Jireh, meaning the Lord provides, also in the Hebrew means to see to it. You see, Genesis chapter number 16 and verse number 13 classifies him as a God who sees. Knowing that he is Jehovah Jireh, my provider, knowing that he is the God who sees, gives me hope in the fact to know that he's a God who sits on high and looks down low. He's a God who knows where I am every single day of the year. He knows where I'm at right now. He knows where I'm going to be tomorrow. He knows where I'm going to be in the next week, in the next month, in the next year. And as he's a God who sits on high and looks down low, he's a God who sees me in those situations. He's a God that provides for me in every situation that is needed. He's a God that sees exactly what I need even before I get to it. He's a God who knows and makes a way. Hallelujah. No matter what it might look like, no matter what it might feel like when we're down into it, he already has a way made out of it. He's already got a way made through it. The only thing that he's asking is that you trust him. Amen. It's hard to follow somebody when you don't trust them. But he begins to name this place Jehovah Jireh, meaning the Lord provides. Meaning that he's a God who sees. He isn't just referring to a God that gives good things. He isn't just referring to somebody who's good in the good times. But he's referring to a God that is Jehovah Jireh, my provider, in the good times and in the bad, in the bright times and in the dark, when it doesn't seem real nice, when it doesn't seem real good, when it doesn't look like you're going to find a way out of it. He's still Jehovah Jireh, my provider. He's still the God that sees. He's still the God who knows where I am. Every step that I take, every move that I make, whether it's in the light of day or it's in the dark of night, he knows where I am and he's going to give me what I need. He's going to be there no matter what. It doesn't matter what the enemy tries to whisper in my ear. It doesn't matter what anybody else tries to tell me. It does not matter what anybody else is doing or where anybody else is going. The only thing that matters is I've got my little hand in his big hand. I'm trusting in him for everything that I've got. I'm not looking to any man. I'm not looking to any place. I'm not looking to anybody else, but I'm looking to Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Knowing that he's going to get me through, knowing that he's going to be there every step of the way. See, he's a God who sees to it. He's a God who sees you in your situation. Matthew chapter number 6 and verse number 8 says, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. Praise the Lord. You see, he already knows what you need before you even get to it. You see, we're a bunch of people who think we know what we need. We don't have a clue. We're a bunch of people who think we've got this thing all wrapped up. We know everything that there is to know. We get to situations and we begin to lean on our own understanding. We begin to go our own way. We begin to go our own thing. But listen, honey, you don't have a clue. You don't know a thing. ...99.9% of the time, when you try to do it on your own, you're going to end up broken, hurt. But when you trust in God, you still might end up broke. But at least you got Him. He is Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Noticeably seeing the supernatural provision of God. Knowing that He's going to make a way where there is no other way. Knowing that when we face these things in life, there's no leaning to the right or to the left, but there's trusting in the fact that we know in somebody who's already been there, who's already done it, who's already made a way through it. We don't have to worry about anything that's going on because we know that He is there. And in noticeably being able to see the provisions of God, we have to put all of our faith and trust in Him. Going back to the fact that we think we know everything that there is to know, knowing that we think that we've got this thing licked, there's a lot of times when we get to places in life that we don't have our full faith and trust in God. You know why? Because we run through our mind the what ifs of the situation. We run through our mind the what ifs of what if this happens? What if this happens? What if I give everything over to God and He asks me to do something? A little quiet on that one. But we, being in the flesh and being human, we want to run through every possible scenario of what's going on. We want to make our own plans. We want to make our own dreams. We want to make our own paths. And we want to run through every possible scenario that's going on. But then when God begins to bring us to these situations, He's not asking you to run through every scenario in your mind. He's not asking you to run through every possibility of what's going on. But He's saying, listen, just trust in Me for everything. Know that I'm going to get you through. Know that I'm going to supply these needs. Know that I'm going to fulfill the details. You know what? We like to know what details are going on. One thing that I've noticed, when you say something, when you schedule something, people want to know the details. When you say something, when you're counseling somebody, when you're praying with somebody, they want to know the details. We, as human beings, schedule out our week. We know what we're going to do every day. If you don't, you're lying to me. Because you know each day what you want to have done. You know where you're going to be. You know what's going to take place. You know details of every possible thing. You know what time, what place, who's going to be there. You know the details. Why? Because it's comforting in knowing the details. It's comforting in knowing everything that there is to know about the schedule that you've got laid out. But you see, what God's beginning to say and what God's beginning to show is the fact that we need to trust in Him for the details. If He's going to be Jehovah Jireh, my provider, then I've got to trust that He can provide. Knowing that He's going to give me the details that I don't have a clue yet. Knowing that He's going to supply my need even before I get there. You know how He's going to supply my need? Because He knows the details of what it's going to take. He knows the details of where I'm going to be. He knows the details of the situation that I'm in. He knows the details of what's going to get me through. Even when I don't have a clue, I know in somebody who does. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Throughout Scripture, he's described as that good shepherd, that chief shepherd, that great shepherd. And you know what the difference is between someone who shepherds sheep and herds sheep? The shepherd leads them. And in him being my provider, he's out in front of me, leading me on those paths of life. Leading me every step of the way. And you know why he's out there leading me through those things? Because when I get to that situation, when I get to that circumstance, when I get to whatever it might be that I don't have a clue what's going on, I can trust in somebody who's already been there, who's already done that, who's already got all the details for what's needed, and all I've got to do is trust in the fact that he's going to lead me through every situation. No matter what it might be, no matter how bad it looks, he is Jehovah Jireh, my provider. You say, how in the world do you know that he can provide? How do you know that he can provide? I could take you on about an hour journey, but Ted would pass out in his seat. I could take you on an hour journey of just how good God has been just in my life. The times that he has provided when I could see no other way. The times that he has provided when everything else was dark and bleak. The times that he's made a way through situations that nobody else could have done it but God. And then I can take you on another hour's journey talking about the saints of God that sit among you tonight and how God has provided every need that they've ever needed. God supplied it food in the cupboard when there was nothing else there. God's provided medication when nobody else could get it. God's given diagnoses when, and he's cured those diagnoses when nobody else could. You see what's up here on the wall? We're talking about the provisions of God. We're talking about Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Not only can I just talk about accounts of those that you know, but we can go to the scripture and look at times that God's provided the need when the need was presented before God. You take a trip down to 2 Kings chapter number 4. We talk about the widow woman who is about faced with losing it all. Her husband had died. She was left with debts that she could not pay. She was left with this stuff that she could not take care of. She was facing losing her children. She was about to lose everything that she had to her name. What'd she do? She ran to the man of God. Got a hold of God. What'd the prophet begin to tell her? What do you have? What do you have to offer God? She says, I don't have a whole lot, but I've got a little cruse of oil. She didn't have anything but a little bit of oil. Even though it didn't seem like a whole lot to anybody that was around her, it was everything that she had and it was everything that she was. And so she gave everything that she was over to God. She said, here's everything that I've got. Here's everything that I am. Use it, God, and allow me to see the benefits of serving you. So the prophet told her, said, gather every vessel that you can, everything that you can get a hold of. Send your boys out. Get everything that you possibly can. Gather it up, bring it in, and start pouring out of that little cruse. And you know what? That probably didn't make a whole lot of sense to her. How in the world is this little cruse of oil going to fill up this whole big bunch of jars that she's collected? But no, when she reached the end of her cruise of oil, she tapped into the supply of God. The Bible says that she gathered all those together. She got in her house. She shut the door. She locked the door. Everybody was in there. And so she began to pour out of that cruise into those vessels. Everything that she was, she began to pour out before the Lord. The Bible says that she poured out of that cruise and it kept a coming. She poured out of that cruise and it kept a coming. She'd fill up one vessel. She'd roll it out of the way. The boys would bring her another. And she filled up every vessel that they had brought in. Now when he told her that, he said, not just a few. But gather everything everybody's got. The Bible says she was able to go and sell those vessels of oil, pay off the debts and keep her family. And that cruise of oil never ran dry. Why? Because he is Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Not only can you look at 2 Kings chapter 4, but you can also flip one more chapter and look at 2 Kings chapter number 5. There's a man by the man of name of Naaman, who was a captain of the host of Syria. He was a mighty man of valor, and he had led the Syrian army to many conquests and many victories. The Bible says there was one problem with him, and he was a leper. And if you know anything about leprosy, if it was found out that you had the disease, you were sent outside the city gates to a leprosy camp, not to be approached, touched, or talked to by anybody around you. And so he was faced with losing everything that he had because of his disease. Then he had an encounter. The Bible says that he had a little Hebrew girl that was a servant in his household. He had tried everything else that he could think of. He hid it for so long. He had wrapped himself up in his armor and in cloth until he had hid it from everybody else. And that little Hebrew girl said, have you tried talking to God about it? And so Naaman went and found the prophet. And so the prophet told him, said, here's what you've got to do. You got to go down to the Jordan River, dip yourself 7 times. And if you don't know anything about the Jordan River, it's a dirty river. And when it's flowing in its high state, it's very dirty, it's silt, it's muddy. It doesn't look very appealing. And so the prophet told Naaman to go down to the Jordan River and dip 7 times. And so he goes down and begins to dip himself in that river. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No change. No change has taken place each and every time he's dipped down. And I'm sure it got pretty frustrating. I'm sure that he was in the midst of this process thinking that this God that he had been talking to was just crazy. This was a strange request. There was no way that anything good was going to come from it. But he had to give everything that he was over to the Lord. The Bible says that on that 7th time, when he came back up out of that water, that flesh upon him was as the flesh of a baby. Flawless. Pure. There's nothing like touching the skin of a baby. The Bible says that as he went down that 7th time and come back up, he was restored. Why? Because of Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Not only does he provide in the here and now, but he provides in the eternity. And when we look at this story in the context It is a beautiful Old Testament picture of the sacrifice of Christ. Because God places His Son on that altar of sacrifice as the payment for the sin of all mankind. And so not only is He provider in the needs that I have today, not only is He provided and knows where I am right now in every situation of this life, but He is my provider in eternity because He has given me a way out of hell and a hope for all eternity. John chapter number 3, verse number 16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. So not only is He a provider in the situations of life, in the circumstances that we face, but He has provided a way out of my sin and into His grace. Because whether you remember or not, there was a time in your life when you were without hope. There was a time in your life when you were wandering out in the darkness of this world. You're out doing whatever pleased yourself. You were out there doing whatever you thought was right in your own eyes. And then came a time and point when God called your name and you stepped out of darkness and into His marvelous light. And it's all because of that shedding of blood. Without that shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And I'm thankful to know tonight that He is Jehovah Jireh, my provider. And I'm thankful to know that in 2020, we can still see the supernatural provisions of the Spirit of God. Do you believe that tonight? That He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore? The same God that was here 50 years ago is the same God that's here right now? The same God that was hung upon that cross? The same God that bled? The same God that died, the same God that was placed in that tomb, same God that rose 3 days later, is the same God that I've still tapped into tonight. He's still Jehovah Jireh. The only thing that's changed is us. And listen, there's needs all over this building. We've got things that we need God to do. We're in the middle of situations that we don't have a clue how it's going to end. We're in the middle of things that we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen next week. But I got good news for you. I know somebody that's already got a way out of it and already got a way through it. You know what he needs? He needs you in full obedience, saying, God, here I am. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. I don't know how you're going to do it, but I know you're going to do it. It's that full faith and trust in Him. That's what it takes. So how's your faith? As your trust, have you given everything over to Him? Or are you still holding on to some stuff? Because God can't move when you're holding on to some things. God can't work when you're holding on to stuff. But what He wants is that full faith in Him. Laying everything out on that altar before Him. Saying, God, here I am. Here's everything that I am. I know I don't see a way through. I know that I don't see how you're going to do it. But I know you're going to do it. As we stand across the building tonight,